We have now, very importantly, we're thankful for you coming, Ulrika, State Secretary of the Minister of International Minister of Foreign Affairs, for the international cooperation part of it. And Ulrika has been, she says on the margin, associated with the creation of Sendai, but actually she was in Sendai, so I think she got a big dose of Sendai there. Secondly, we have stakeholder representatives here beyond governments. Fredrik Jonsson is now the Director of Contingency Planning and Crisis Management in the County Administrative Board in Jönköping. And of course, Fredrik is here as a good representative of the activist local governments and regional government. Important in Sweden because of our decentralization, but also part of that very important big group of tens of thousands local government. And you heard what Jack said about the linchpin, which he placed at the local government and their authority. So I don't think you were set up to say that. You actually believe it. Thirdly, Mats Andersson is now the Vice Chairman of the Global Challenges Foundation. But of course, formerly the CEO of one of our very big pension funds. And in that capacity, I met Mats in occasions of building commitment towards how to tackle climate change together. So I suspect that's what he will talk about. So in our previous panel, it was set up as an international panel with Andrew Musgrave doing an introduction of where we come to, a summary of the way our knowledge about risk, socioeconomic impact, how to measure risk, and a bit an outlook to the future. So that's what UNISDR has been working with, but it's not UNISDR, it's UNISDR with all of you and then hundreds of partners around the world who committed to this. Jack Radish from OECD, also another partnership on how OECD handles risk management support for governments. The High Level Risk Forum has been the venue, the mechanism that they used. And as you, I'm sure you know, there is a framework also for risk management in the OECD. And if you read that and Sendai together, you will see that we work closely together, which is the purpose of the exercise. And the third participant is, of course, Stephanie, who is the linchpin in the Canadian Public Safety Ministry for Disaster Risk Reduction, also chair of the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction, and in fact, the acting assistant deputy minister and director general. And particularly interesting, of course, Canada is a very hazard-exposed country, but had also built, in a relatively short period of time for such a huge country, a very interesting way of working with disaster risk reduction in different ways. So in the discussion that then came out of this, there were some things that really attracted attention. One is the whole challenge of governance. And I call it a challenge because I think it's fair to say it's seen as, if we can't get our hands around what the governance models are, it's very difficult with implementation. But we had very good thinking around that, so I believe there's positive signs. The metrics, how to measure risk and how to measure the cost of inaction, as we say, but also risk understanding is another metric. Actually, not everyone sees risk the same way. A very important discussion, which was just in the beginning, is the issue of trade-offs. We had a question from the audience here around one of our big lakes in Sweden, Vättern, as an example of how people have very different perspectives on what is the right course of action. Is it the nature? Is it the polluted water? Is it fish, etc.? And important for this discussion, where do these discussions that reach trade-offs, where do they take place? and how are they managed, and who's responsible for the ultimate trade-off, so to say, somewhere it has to land. And then I think we had two more things. The absolute critical importance of, Stephanie underlined that also, continued focus on building awareness and risk understanding. And finally, you will be delighted to know, it all goes back to political will. So that's where we ended up. This session now is very much around Swedish implementation in Sendai in Sweden, of course, but given what you are working with, we also see you, Ulrika, specifically. What role does Sweden assume also in carrying these important commitments globally and in our international cooperation? So with that, you have been offered to make a short introduction, each one of you, and then we will guide you with our questions on what's most important. So you decide what you're comfortable with, but 5 minutes or so introduction, and then we will, and there will be a lot of questions from the audience. So Ulrika, why don't you start, please?
Thank you, Margareta, for this possibility. And maybe I then can start with the political will. And I think, I mean, it has been said also that Sweden is really engaged, both as a financing partner to the framework, but also relating this to our engagement in our development cooperation, and not least relating it to the important decisions taken in 2015, both on sustainable development goals and the agenda for financing the development goals and the Paris Agreement. So I think, I mean, the political will was at least shown in 2015. I am not so sure we would have the same kind of bold and good decision this year. So I'm happy that the world community and the world leaders actually took them in 2015. Mm-hmm. And now in these times where we have a lot of challenges ahead of us, I think politically, but also, I mean, with a world where only 50% of the humanitarian needs are covered by development cooperation support and humanitarian support, we really need to see to that we stay with the plans that we decided upon back in 2015 and see how we can coordinate these different frameworks so that we bring these plans into action. And there I think that Sweden, as a country, but also as one of the countries that believe a lot in multilateral partnership, both in the normative framework and the importance of using this knowledge, because it was very much a knowledge-based decision, both the climate agreement, but also the decisions on the SDGs finally, and also on the Sendai framework. So we need to continue to work to see to that this normative frameworks stay there, but also, of course, for people to believe in them, to bring them into action, and do that through our support financially, through active participation, and make good use of, I think, all the experiences that we have within the broad network of actors of development cooperation. I'm talking about the multilateral actors, but also, of course, countries and our bilateral cooperation, our civil society cooperation, and also the experience that we have through a lot of partnerships through our different authorities and also at the local and regional level. Because what was brought forward, and this you have mentioned several times, which was quite unique with the Sendai framework, was that it was actually more of what we want to see also as part of our development cooperation, a true partnership, where a lot of experiences are actually found in the Global South that we can have a good use of. But of course, then we also have a lot of experience in our own country. So it's actually also a possibility to bring what we also say within the Agenda 2030, our international cooperation into more of partnership and sharing of experiences. And this is also what the Paris Agreement says, of course, that it's about sharing technique and good experience to see to that we bring this work forward.
You want to continue a bit, or?
I think I can stop there and then come back.
Okay, yeah. Good. Thank you. Fredrik, your opening reflections.
Okay, so thank you for letting me come here. I represent the Jönköping, city of Jönköping. Actually, when I was asked to come here, I was a representative of the city of Jönköping. When I have changed employer, so I represent the county administrative board. But I'm going to tell a little about DRR and how we have implemented that in city of Jönköping. So I'll start with that. So Jönköping is the 10th largest city in Sweden, actually situated by the Lake Vättern, as been discussed. And it's one of our most protective, that we need to protect, values that we have to protect is the, our drinking water in Lake Vättern, so I agree with that. In Jönköping, we have developed a local political agenda. We call it safety and security, because for in the national level, there isn't such a framework done in the nation. But on the local level, some local authorities have made a local framework putting together safety and security. Even Saler, Swedish local authorities association, has supported that way of working. So that has been very beneficial. And that covers actually crime prevention and security issues, contingency planning, emergency planning, and accident preventions. But now we have also included climate change adaptation in that framework on the local level. So how do one include DRR in that perspective? So DRR is not new to us, but it's a perspective on that has needs to be worked in the way we work in Jönköping. So has this work with DRR and with Yugo Framework for Action or Sendai, has it benefit to our work? And I would say yes, a lot. Because thanks to MSB, we have been given opportunity to have international exchange and been able to evaluate our local work to an international standard. And then we have discovered some lacks and some gaps that we really have addressed now from doing this comparisons between our way to work and the international standards. So some clear fields that we have adopted. I think I stay there.
Thanks for inviting me as well. My name is Mats Andersson, and I will share with you some thoughts from the period at AP4, was running the public pension fund here in Sweden, and some thoughts from my role as vice chairman of Global Challenges Foundation. At AP4, some 5 years ago, we concluded that climate change was for real. We also concluded that there must be a way for a long-term investor to actually mitigate the climate risk. And we implemented and found strategies to do that. So we lowered the carbon footprint in our equity portfolio by some 30%. At the same time, we increased our returns. The point is you can actually find ways where you mitigate risk and you actually lower the risk in your portfolio at the same time. You don't have to give up returns. I'm a strong believer that if you want change, you need to do it from economical reasons. That's the only time we really will see reallocation of capital. We were also able to as one of four founders of a coalition, we promised at the climate meeting in 2014 at UN to deliver 100 billion of pension capital that was put into strategies to lower the climate change for the Paris meeting, COP21, 2015. And we were able to deliver a coalition with 30 members controlling some $3.2 trillion, and that 600 billion actually were put into different strategies to lower the impact on climate. So what I'm saying is it's possible to actually do things. It was regarded when we started as impossible. 5 years ago, when I visited 10 of the world's biggest, 20 biggest pension funds, none of them had a clue on climate change. None of them had a clue about their exposure. Today, it's a totally different story. So things are changing, and I think the financial sector that I'm representing have a big role to play in this transition, but we need to get the right prices for actually reallocating capital. And I strongly believe that if you want to tackle climate change, we need a carbon tax. We might come back to that. Then on my work at Global Challenge Foundation, it was founded some 5 years ago by my old mentor, Laszlo Szombat-Falvi. And he was a strong believer that global catastrophic risks are underestimated by decision makers, be that in the private sector or be that by politicians. So the foundation has got two objectives, two missions. Number one is to inform about the global catastrophic risks, defined as something that could hit 10% of this world's population. That could be climate change, extreme poverty, mass destruction weapons, etc. Because the belief is you need to understand the risk if you want to mitigate them. We have also, I'm proud to say, been signing on as a sponsor at the Stockholm School of Economics. So it's now mandatory for everyone at Stockholm School of Economics to take a course on global catastrophic risks. It's a support that are given for the coming 10 years. Secondly, if we want to change, you need to start with governance. And Laszlo's view is, and I strongly believe he's right, is that today we don't have governance models to actually tackle the global catastrophic risks. The most sort of global governance structure we have is UN, and it was formed in, well, some 70 years ago for the challenges we had at that time. We need something new today. The foundation has launched a new prize, the new shape, and it's a prize where we ask people to come up with ideas on how to find a new governance model like that could actually tackle and mitigate the kind of risks we have today. And $5 million have been set aside for this competition. It was launched in December, and so far some 13,000 people have actually signed on that they want to compete, representing more than 180 countries. So I think that the topic in itself has never been sort of more viable and more interesting than it is today. I think I stop there.
Okay, good. So first, I just wanted you to comment on this governance dilemma, because Ulrika, you talked about coordination.
Sorry. Oh, you miss it, yeah.
I'll go to my mic. Yes. Thank you, Ylva. I saw you start walking towards me. I knew there was something wrong. on the governance, if I can have some comments from all of you, because you've all been there, so to speak, already. But concretely, Ulrika touched on the global dilemma, which is also what Mats now touched on, where in the global structure, I mean, I obviously, if you ask me, I have an answer, but I'm not going to tell you. How to deal with the coordination, and above all, Ulrika, the coherence challenge. You remember the catchword in 2015 was coherence, which actually meant that in an ideal world, and maybe it will be 2031, that ideal world will exist, we have not four separate global policy processes that all deal with sustainability and stability, but one. Maybe. So for you, that Fredrik, already you already said that you do have a local governance, sort of. Can you just develop that a little bit?
Yes.
But also tell us what the challenges are. And Mats, if I take this a bit from, if you look at, you participated a lot with private sector, financial industry, etc. What for them do you think would constitute a governance model that would give them sufficient confidence in that they and governments can cohabitate in the same territory and do trade-offs together? Ulrika, after that I will let all of you start.
Yeah. Hopefully it's easier to organize Jönköping than it is to organize the world within the UN system. But I also said, and I can say it again, that we believe in multilateralism. But this is not to say that we don't have to take other initiatives like you have been presenting here. I think we can do both, and I think this is very also well known. And these days Isabella Lövin is, for instance, visiting California, not Washington, for given reasons, and signing climate agreements with the state of California, which will benefit a lot, I think, trade and innovation and so on. So there are always solutions, but at the same time, I mean, and this, you know, we have said it so many times, the UN is a mirror of the world as it is, and hopefully also as we would like it to be. And I do think in these times that we need, and I think that 2015 showed, even though that these frameworks are overlapping and quite complicated, and you would say that the indicators are not precise enough to be really drivers of change within the SDG agenda and so on, but still, I mean, it's the first time, and we now also have a leadership, a new leadership within the UN. And I strongly believe that both Guterres and Amina Mohammed are actually personalities that we need to see if they actually can bring the UN system to be more fit for purpose, as we have been trying many times before. But still, when I talk with a lot of my colleagues in other countries, we actually do believe that this time we can move things forward. And also, I mean, they are leaders that have worked within the system on the ground. So I think that they are very eager to see too that we get from word into action. And it's about the normative frameworks. I mean, we can't take anything for given. When I talk about 2015, we may also move back to when we took the decisions on the human rights framework after the Second World War. It's not a given any longer. So we need also to defend the normative work and the discussions that we have within the UN system. But I think we can do and need to do and take other initiatives at the same time. So I think, I mean, we're in good partnership here, both at the local level and also from the private sector investors and from the government. And we need to, as Sweden, to see how we can coordinate and also bring. And I think that maybe the Addis agenda, which is the financing agenda for the sustainability goals, was, and I don't know, Mats, I think you participated also in, you followed it a bit.
Absolutely.
So was an example where the UN also has started with its huge, administration and so on, to open up for a broader engagement, and it's of course needed because the UN will not be financed and the sustainability agenda will not be financed through development cooperation or assessed contributions from the member states any longer.
Good, thank you.
Well, from a local perspective, first of all, I must point out that we does not have a perfect system in the city of Jönköping due to this. It's not. But we have tried to build something and to put together something that really responds and get the political attention within our city administrative board. And actually, the challenge is that in within Sweden, on the local level, there are so many legislations in small, relatively small areas that are separate, and they come from the governmental level down to the local level, and there is not really a framework to put it in. Therefore, we have tried to make this framework from the different areas, from the areas of civil defense, actually. It's now addressed a lot, and crisis management, risk and vulnerability analysis, and those kinds of things together in one framework. The real challenge with that is that trying to address the different legislations and the different governance from the national level towards the local level, and to be able to report in the right form, to be able to use the right language. It's like a blanket with different kinds of holes in it, that some areas are not covered with any legislation or any framework at all, and some of it it's covered with different layers, over layers, and can be addressed with different, many different areas within this framework. So I think that is the the biggest issue, or the biggest challenge, is to make it understandable and to make it together, so this area will be, this political area would be so big that it could be on the political agenda for our top politicians in Jönköping. Yes.
Thank you.
On the private sector and the interest of taking part in this transition that we need to do, I think it's never been bigger than it is today. And I have to say that if I look at the four categories of municipalities, cities and regions. And if you look at companies and then the financial sector and the local politicians or the national politicians, I must say that regions have been far ahead in the game of actual sustainability, especially on the climate side. We have cities like Växjö where they say that sustainability is no more a debate among the parties, it's set aside. And we have so many good examples, actually. On the private sector, we have companies like IKEA, H&M, that are in the forefront of this. And they're not doing it because it's looking good or it's charity. They're doing it because they know that long-term sustainability and tackling climate change, whatever, is a way to survive, a way to build your brand long-term and to build your P&L long-term. So I think all what is needed is actually to put the right price on the risk. And the risk is, in climate, it's all about the CO2 emissions. And we know that companies like Unilever is actually using a shadow price when they invest to make sure that once the tax will come, and believe me, it will come, they are actually more prepared for this than their competitors, hopefully. So it will pay off. So if you have the long-term view, and I think the financial sector has a lot to catch up, I think we've been far behind in this game. But again, if you give us the right incentives, it's not about charity again, but if you can give us the right incentives to make renewable energy more profitable, which is pretty easy again if you introduce a tax. And again, Sweden has had a tax on carbon since the beginning of the 90s, and we've proven, I guess, that you can actually have very good growth in your economy and you can at the same time actually lower your emissions. So I think they're good examples, and I think you should try to find better platforms, but again, use the economy or taxes, whatever it is, to make sure that you get the right kind of behavior.
Maybe just also to mention that we now have a broad agreement on 100% renewable energy to 2014, which is also a very important decision, and that can also show as an example. And we will use it as an example also.
Good, thank you. Now I'd like to open the floor and hands up. While I see hands going up, I will ask Andrew, can you move a little bit into this territory of pricing risk? From the side of the work that there's a mic there to Andrew. That's the guy. So then I took note of 1, 2, 3 questions afterwards.
Well, I'll relate this a little bit to what Mr. Anderson referred to. We've also been working quite closely with the private sector in our work with the global risk model, and I'll give just two sort of practical examples of how that's worked out in practice. One piece of work we've done is we've been working actually with the Economist Intelligence Unit, that's the sort of in business intelligence part of the Economist magazine, building disaster risk actually into their what they call operational risk model. Because a company which maybe say is wanting to invest several hundred millions in Southeast Asia and is trying to decide whether it wants to put its plant in Thailand, Malaysia, or Indonesia. Up to now, if they've gone to, say, the Economist Intelligence Unit or similar organizations for the sort of business intelligence, they've been given a lot of information regarding risks of currency fluctuations, labor market risks, can I get my money out of a country, and this kind of thing. But they've never really been given information on disaster and climate risks. So a lot of those sort of investment decisions have been taken blind. So again, we've been working with them, for example, to integrate our quantitative risk metrics into their broader metrics. And we think this is kind of critical because it's a sort of a small intervention that can then actually then steer potentially billions, if not trillions, of private sector investment as we go forward into the future. So that's one example. And a second example I will use, which actually comes from Japan, is, and again refers to issues Mr. Anderson raised, companies in particularly now in the Japan housing and real estate sector, working in both residential and industrial and commercial property, have generally identified that, again, using the risk metrics, and building their buildings to a higher standard so they can actually offer sort of disaster resilience as part of their value chain? Are they able to actually get higher rents, higher prices, more stable tenancies? So I think the key way we can use these sort of metrics is to actually turn, sort of, as I said, risk is both a threat and an opportunity. So actually, how do we turn this actually into a value proposition? And if we can do that, then somehow I think we've cracked a lot of the problem.
Good. I will ask Stephanie to prepare to I will not ask Ulrika, because I think it's better to ask you. What can governments do? What can central governments do to help local governments with this dilemma of the blanket with empty holes in? That centrally instruct, because it's such a dilemma, and the UN also helps with the new policy to go far away from here, municipalities in Philippines, when you find that they have a half-time person supposedly planning for disaster risk reduction, climate change adaptation, sustainable development, the health sector, and then something new comes and the government automatically sends it down. That's good, but they still have only half-time person. So what can be done?
So I'll be in my attempt. I think it's to bring in local government into that solution space, because at the national level, we know what we know. And I think as we develop these integrated policy solutions, is to really understand what are the implications at all levels. And I think that takes a different type of policy development, and it's a more inclusive one. Because there is innovation at the local level, that is where a lot can be done. And I think it's not to take that traditional perspective that, that paternalistic type of approach of a national government. So I would say, being a public servant, though, I mean, not a political appointee, but it is about providing that best advice and to bring in all the different key stakeholders, including industry, in the policy development space, so to co-develop. And I think to have those discussions early on, not when we're ready to seek support, but as we're shaping the thinking. So earlier engagement, creating those safe spaces and the trust, because at the end of the day, we're all in it together. So I think it's a different it's a paradigm shift as far as how we develop public policy.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, good examples, I think, are very important drivers of change. You mentioned Växjö, but there are also other municipalities and regions in Sweden, but we also have examples where we would like to see, perhaps, or need to see more action, because many of these things, I mean, the good examples can, of course, be used in other places, but then we also have in some regions in Sweden, and I guess you mentioned perhaps some of these before, major investments that need to be done. And there, of course, I mean, the politicians at local level, it's very difficult if you're going to make such a huge investment to put it forward as a necessity, and many times as a shared necessity. If you talk about the Lake of Mälaren, for instance, I mean, you can ask the municipalities around the lake whether they actually have made or even put forward the plans that they need to put forward, and whether there is a discussion from the local level towards the national level on the necessity. So sometimes people also shy away from responsibility because the investments that need to be done are so huge, and they know that it's difficult at the local level, sharing costs, but and that at perhaps the national level, it's also difficult sometimes to get the money. So
it's also to it's also, I think, important to understand the return on investment because it is about contribution from all different levels of government. Yes. So understanding, you know, investing in this will yield certain returns, I think it's how you quantify the focus. But it's not easy. So I'm not saying it sounds easy, but it's certainly not. It's all in execution.
You have started a discussion here now, you can see. So both Fredrik and Mats would like to comment, please.
Yes, I completely agree with that. And because our next step to take is to engage more of the stakeholders, the local stakeholders, and make agreements. Now the DRR work or the work is much driven by the local authority level, the authorities, but taking on the other stakeholders and to make agreements, that would be the next step. So we have focused there, and that is stressed more in the Sendai framework, I would say, than Hugo framework for action. So we can see that as a benefit from Sendai, and giving us encouragement to do that even more. And the other one, other thing I would like to say is a really practical example where we have gained benefits from using data on the local level. We have for developing safety and security, we have used cost-benefit analysis on a basis that we have collected data and can prove that different kinds of solutions actually would pay back more than they cost. And that, putting to the politicians, has been really successful to gain more security and safety in Jönköping. So I agree with that.
On financing, I have to say that it's a conundrum. I mean, we have, as we speak, about $10 trillion of bonds running with a negative interest rate. Mm-hmm. So there's got to be investment possibilities better than ever to do the transition we need to do. And I went to see, there's an entity called Kommuninvest. It's a debt office for many of the municipalities, could be Jönköping as well, I guess. And they are complaining not about having too much to finance, it's rather the other way around. They are looking for green investments among their members or their owners. So there is not a demand problem for this, it's rather supply.
And packaging, I think, of the project.
Making it bankable as well, yeah.
Good. So I suspect we will come back to, because these are the core issues on the implementation we are right now. So let's keep that in mind. But now we'll go to first Johan Shah. I've introduced you.
Thank
and then
you
we
much.
Had two more questions.
Yes, thank you. A question for the State Secretary, Ulrika. The Hyogo and Sendai frameworks and processes assume that we are dealing with governments who are in charge and in principle capable of taking the measures and implementing what is needed in order to reduce disaster risk. But of course this is not completely true. We need to think about countries who are fragile or weak, like Northeast Nigeria, like Somalia, like Yemen, like Afghanistan. Who are in conflict, where often institutions, functioning institutions that can take and implement the measures necessary, don't exist. And of course, these countries are as affected as all other countries by climate change and so on. And where the impacts of disasters or climate change could even fuel ongoing tensions and ongoing conflict. So these two entities or these two groups of countries are dealt with completely differently in the international system. What could be done and what could Sweden do in order to sort of bring these two together to see this in a more holistic fashion?
So I think I mentioned, I mean, we know that the humanitarian needs are escalating a lot the recent years and that we only have about 50% of the financing needed. And one of the problems that we see now is that when I refer to normative action on the importance of normative frameworks, I mean, we really need to get them moving, because within these discussions we talk a lot about the importance of prevention. We talk about it in the Sendai framework, we talk about it as, I mean, the whole SDG agenda is actually about prevention. In the Security Council, I think we have also, and this has also been a contribution from Sweden, that when we had the first month in January, to see to that we had a discussion with the new Secretary General on the importance of prevention. And we talk about prevention also, of course, with regard to mitigation and preparedness and so on in relation to climate change. But at the same time, one of the problems is that, I mean, we move more towards financing relief and humanitarian support. The money is moving, talking about money moving there. So we need to see how we do this in the best way. And I think that the grand bargain in the humanitarian summit, where we also talked about prevention, is really important, because there we finally discuss the bridge between long-time humanitarian support, long-time development cooperation and humanitarian support, and the necessity, and this we do also by experience, to even in countries where we have real weak structures, fragile and conflict-ridden states, also see how we can support institutions, at least at the local level. So the Syria crisis strategy is one example where Sweden, with the experience of what happened in Iraq, when the international community only worked with humanitarian support, there was no support to the local institutions, and they lost a lot of their functionality since the international community only supported with humanitarian, traditional humanitarian support at that time. So this is one way we have been working in the surroundings of the Syria crisis, but also, I mean, you mentioned Somalia and other countries too. They're very long-term projects, but we need to see too that we are not so eager about the results that we move on to direct implementation, but that we actually support institution building even in the weakest countries. Liberia and the example of Ebola is another, I think, very concrete, once again, experience of how we have invested a lot in development cooperation in the country, but not invested enough in support to real institution building. But then, of course, as you started, the political will need to be there, so it's sometimes difficult to match, but we know that if we don't do it, we are doing the wrong investments, and it's possible. We have experiences when we have not done it, and this has been a disaster in itself, and where we have actually done it and how it can be done.
On this same issue, Mats?
Yes, okay.
So there are also another group of countries, not just the ones we describe as fragile or weak, or the countries who make good trade-offs, but countries where you have governments who may not actually be able to muster the real understanding of the institutional structures that prevent this kind of wise solution. I've seen that in a number of middle-income countries which want to confront, perhaps at some high level, the complexities which go even beyond financial crisis, food crisis, fuel crisis. When you add all of this together, it's an enormous challenge for a political leadership to make reform. But these reforms are then linked to institutions which often do not want to lose their particular interests. So I just wanted to introduce the term interest and other kinds of constraints that are there. It's not just about being rational or building institutions where they aren't. There are competing institutions that must be revealed in order for you to get to these problematic, even more complex political changes that are now needed together with economics.
Thank you. If I just, on the Sendai framework, like in the other policy frameworks in 2015, there was this always the intense discussion brought forward by regions. What about countries in conflict? We have to have conflict as a factor in these frameworks because it prevents, you know, us achieving development goals, etc. But because of global politics, they haven't made it in there explicitly. And the global politics, it's very simple. If it's about an international conflict, it's okay, but if it's about local conflict, please stay out of it. It's about sovereignty, so it's very easy to see this. But in the SDGs, you have goal 16, which is a sort of way of dealing with that. Perhaps not perfect, but it's better than avoiding the issue. And the way it was solved in Sendai is a little bit convoluted, but it's there. There is a statement somewhere about countries in special circumstances. And what is countries in special circumstances? Well, it's actually, because if Andrew has taught me correctly on the GAR 11, is it? The countries that actually have the highest risk are the middle-income countries because their institutions are softer. So if you would look at low LDCs, middle income and the richest countries, it's the middle incomes that are the most in trouble, actually, because of the institutional issues. So you're completely right there. And the other country in special circumstances are actually countries in conflict situations. When you find that paragraph, you can do whatever you want with Sendai, if you are bound by frameworks rather than realities. So just to say that the elements are there, but since it has not been properly worked through, and I think not working it through properly would be something that we hope now that the SD will lead in his sustainable and inclusive peace and these things. Mm.
And the majority of the poorest of the poor will live in conflict-ridden countries in just some few decades.
So we'll have to keep attention on that. Did you get the microphone? Yeah, good.
Yes. Is it on? Yeah, great. First, I would just like to say thank you to MSB and we for inviting us. It's been really, really, really interesting and needed for the conference in Mexico. And Andrew, thank you for GAR. It's one of our sources for information. It's fantastic. My name is Olivia. I'm representing an organization called Plan International and working with Child Center Disaster Risk Reduction. So we're focusing on kids. And I would like to say with my experience with working with disaster risk reduction during these last 10 years has been that we really have the evidence that it's really working, it's saving lives and resources, and I think we're all on the same page that it's a good investment. We are focusing a lot on schools, which I saw in the Sendai framework. It was excellent. The education was really brought up as important as, you know, disaster risk reduction is about knowledge and sharing. And I want to reconnect to what we said in the first session about that Andrew said something about managing a disaster. There's also a need to manage the risk. And this is something that we really have seen in our programs where we're working both with development but also humanitarian. That when we have a humanitarian disaster, we also need to really focus on risks to not increase the risk of having another humanitarian disaster, since we're there to also do less harm. And having risk reduction, different actions being brought into the humanitarian response is something that we've seen is life-saving, as I want to connect with the lady from Canada, that it also reduces the vulnerability when, for instance, for us, when we're working with children, to increase their capacity, that you really understand what happened. In Nepal, the children didn't understand there was an earthquake or what to do, and by them, for instance, learning that, okay, this was happened, it's dangerous to go into buildings, then it also increased their healing and be able to go back to a normal day-to-day life and go back to schools, for instance. But there is an issue that we've seen during these last few months. We have really had long-term good cooperation with CEDA, and we're really positive of all the support in DRR that we enjoyed for a long time. But we see that there is becoming a kind of a shrinking space for actually talking about DRR in humanitarian action. And we know this discussion that you just mentioned about bridging has been an excellent step forward, since we do have a lot of development countries, but also humanitarian countries that we work in. But there is a problem also with the bridging, that a lot of the countries that have been phased out from development corporations are the ones who are having humanitarian crisis over and over again. And many of the countries that really needs our support due to the escalating climate change also need to really focus on DRR, and from them it's becoming stronger and stronger voice that we understand this, we are on the Sendai, we are on Agenda 2030, and we want to move this further. So our concern is just that we might not be able to live up to that and actually bring the plans into action, because we are one of the ones who actually do that into the to the field. So I would just wonder what your take is on that, because we really think also that DRR is saving lives, not just before a crisis, but also during a crisis, especially afterwards as well. especially when it comes to children and youth as well. Thank you.
We'll take one more question before I pass it, because then we are probably out of time. So we'll give all the three of you a chance to comment on whatever you feel like.
Please. I want to make a question to Mats Andersson, who are giving advice to investments. Do you ban investments in mass destruction weapons? Perhaps, but do you ban investments in military, in weapons? Because the growing militarization of the world is also very danger to the environment. So I want to know.
Important question. I don't know if you want to take that up and broaden it also into other areas. We had some specific questions here also, but can I add one or two final reflections from you? One is, what can we do to tackle, which seems to be the number one priority everywhere, awareness? Mm-hmm. Any closing thoughts on that? And second question is, is there something particularly important that would be helpful for you that can come out of the Cancun meeting that takes place in 5 weeks or something like that? Ulrika, would you like to start? Yeah.
Well, just with regard to your question from Plan, I don't know if there's someone from SIDA here who has more answers than I do with regard to your specific questions, but the government took a decision on a new policy framework for our development cooperation in December last year. And the introductory chapter states very clearly the relation between, as I did in the introduction, maybe not that clearly, but I tried to at least, the relation between the frameworks. So, I mean, it should be there, and I don't know where you look for your support or so, but maybe we can continue that discussion, and I can see if I can and help you out. But it should, of course, be possible to find a way to discuss this with SIDA. And SIDA, as you know, works through civil society organizations, but also in broader and not least also supporting multilateral organizations. So let's see if I can guide you perhaps or find a way to. And with regard to awareness, I think, I mean, we talked about, Mats said that, I mean, we need to put a price and to show that this is actually an investment, a long-term investment. And I think that awareness is, and I agree, I mean, it's much more there now also at the political level. Otherwise, we would not have had those decisions in 2015. So we need to make good use of that momentum that actually politicians took decision based on knowledge. I mean, this is also something, talking about facts and alternative facts and so on. We need to stay with that. But also, and what gets measured gets done is also said many times. So the awareness is there, but the problem is many times that, and I think that this was something that Mats perhaps also were aiming at, that it's difficult, it's tricky politically to take those decisions that you know that you should take. So then of course you need to get the awareness out in the broader society and so on. But I think pricing and also to see to showcase through the examples that we have, and I think that there are interesting examples also the Philippines or other countries where investments have been made, and they can show that it actually resulted in less problems and less costs. So I think I understand that in the yearly report, I mean, there are very good examples, 650 cities that have analyzed, 90 countries that has more data with regard to this. We have 18 different platforms working with examples. So that kind of knowledge base and a proof that we actually build now with good use of the framework needs to get back to the politicians who took the decisions and back to the broader society. Mm-hmm. So make good use of all these actions that are actually taken, and not least the data and the kind of proof that we find within also the UN system. 13 of the funds and programs have now prioritized and so on. So things are happening now as a result of the framework, and we need to take that back to the politicians at a high level and incentivize and to showcase. And also make good use of people like you and I mean local examples to push the politicians.
Yeah. Well, okay. I can address the question with awareness, I think. We have found out that when we address the 10 essentials and those indicators, we found out that it's a difference if you're facing, if you are a city or a region that face one major single hazard. Could be an earthquake or anything that is overwhelming and is very, very large in proportion to other risks. If you are like Jönköping and many other cities, I would say in Sweden and in other parts, there is not one single hazard. There are many smaller hazards or smaller risks. We have found out that it is more beneficial to change focus towards contingency planning rather than focus on this single risk. Therefore, our focus on awareness is not awareness of risk, but awareness of every people, every organization, every stakeholders' contingency planning. So that is, I think, it's a difference if you are addressing a major risk or a multi-hazard environment. And for Cancun, I would say it would be really good if we could develop something to gather all the knowledge, the data, to be able to spread the knowledge of what measures does really work, and to be able to go from something that is a good idea towards something that is we have an evidence for the worth of that issue. So that is what I would like to see.
First of all, the question about mass destruction weapons and whether the APs hold those kind of companies. Exclusion is for the ethical council that is controlled by the four APs, and I don't have that on top of my mind where we are on that, so I need to come back on that. A remark I could do is it's been estimated that we spend on every day 4 billion US on armies, soldiers, etc. And I think that's a frightening number. And if you could imagine what you could do with those $4 billion a day if you had organized this a different way. On awareness, I think it's all about communication, trying to find ways to actually make the man in the street understand where we're heading. Take the climate change, and we have the Paris Agreement. Why don't we report every half year on where we are? Where is the action plan for how we should come to actually live up to the Paris Agreement? Then on Mexico, or next conference, I hope that it will be debated, the governance again, the governance models. I think that governance is actually the toolbox you can use. And I think that we were actually having a toolbox of yesterday trying to address today's problems, and that ain't going to work. Thanks.
May I just comment quickly, yes, Margareta? Please. Because I'm so happy that we, in this spring budget that was presented, was it yesterday or the day before?
Yesterday.
We actually have for the first time presented indicators in relation to our responsibility for implementing the SDGs, broader measurements than the GDP. So I think that this, it was a work that has been prepared for a long time, and finally we see it. And also there is a specific chapter on following up on environment and climate for the first time in the spring budget of the Swedish government. So at least one step or two step at the same time.
So there is some action. Thank you. Good, so let's thank the panel, and then I'll quickly summarize. This was very much about implementation, of course, and different perspectives, but some of the key things that the panelists, we kept on with governance as really a key toolbox, as Mats now call it. The awareness through practice, I think that's what Fredrik illustrated. It's not awareness, it is also awareness as a
you know, monologue on education. It's awareness through the practice, building on the best knowledge we have. And if we think about that as an awareness-raising instrument, maybe we will feel that we make progress. But I think really what you helped us with here, and Ulrika, you underline it, there is progress, and we even measure it, but we don't see it because we are in the middle of things, and we have the feeling sometimes that we discuss the same issues and we forget to actually take note of the progress that is happening. And we are working in a 10 plus 10 year perspective, actually 10 plus 15. Now there is a sense of urgency that must not get lost, and that urgency is a very real issue for many people who live in much more dire environments than we do here in Sweden. So that sense of urgency, I think, really needs to be sustained. And people like Fredrik and Mats needs to keep pushing the agenda to help governments to move in the right direction. I think Ulrika invited us to do that. The political will needs constant incentives, just like everybody else need constant incentive in the type of reinforcement that things are changing and we have an impact. So this can be very concrete things, and they will be different for the business sector and different for local governments. But I think I understand that. And you know, Andrew presented talking about metrics, which is an important tool, the indicators. Andrew demonstrated here in the first panel that how the indicators for the Sendai targets actually have the corollary in the SDG indicators. So we worked hard between these processes to make sure that they speak to each other. So I hope with the next budget you will have the Sendai indicators also included in the budget. Mm-hmm. And just so that you don't remember, you will get 7 targets here.
Very good. Thank you.
This is the prize. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, as you know, this whole event has been filmed, so you will all now be available on YouTube, and therefore please keep engaging with the questions, discussions, and use them. And I think all the panelists that we've had here today, Jack, Andrew, Stephanie, Mats, Fredrik, and Ulrika, they are now your resources to take this discussion into the future. And all the time, remember that things are happening. We are making progress. We are learning. And it's actually going quite quickly now. Finally, Ulrika expressed strong trust in that the UN can be that governance mechanism, instrument also for...
Hope, at least, if not trust.
You said, well, we hope, but we need to work very hard on our hopes these days, not only in the UN. So I think, let's give the new Secretary General and his team, and they are all very knowledgeable about the issues, so that is not the obstacle. Let's give them our trust for a few years and help them to build that governance basis. So thank you for joining us today. Thank you again to MSB, to Institute for Foreign Relations, Mats and Nils, and everyone who's made this possible. And I hope we can do this again in another maybe 6 months after Cancun and see what came out of Cancun. Thank you all.